Hey folks, Coach Chris here. I am going to discuss really two of my favorite topics, my favorite races, Boston Marathon and the New York City Marathon. And specifically what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a course comparison between those, and I'm going to look at some of the numbers. I've seen this question come up multiple times, and I was like, hey, I know the answer to that. So why don't I put together a little presentation for people so this is, you know, readily accessible information. All right, the first thing I did is I went to findmymarathons.com and I took the elevation chart from there, and it's right here on this slide. The reason I did that is these both have the same scale, so it's very easy then to compare between them and see where are the hills, where are the not hills, when they're using the same scale and the same graphic language. So that is just a visual quick overview for you. And now we're going to look into the numbers. The Boston Marathon gains 815 feet. The New York City Marathon gains 810 feet. So easy math there, right? 5 feet of difference. That's pretty gosh darn the same. The other thing that is the same, and you will never hear this anywhere else, but both races are downhill races. Nobody ever talks about New York City Marathon as a downhill race. The reason being, it is a 14-foot difference, and it's just silly to, you know, term things like that. But on paper, yes, this is the case. Boston is a much more frequently discussed downhill marathon because it is more significantly downhill. And so it loses 1,275 feet, and that ends up as a net of 460 feet. So again, there's scales and ratios of things. There are races that are far, far, far more downhill. But Boston is definitely more downhill than New York. However, in terms of just gain perspective, they both gain just almost dead even, 5 feet difference. All right, so now we're going to look at the climbs. And whenever anybody runs New York City Marathon, the first thing they will, one of the first things they'll mention is the bridges. The bridges are distinctive in that they are very obviously a climb. Like, you can see it before you. The roadway is changing. You are obviously going over a body of water, right? Which is the purpose of a bridge. And so it is very distinguishable in that you are going to go up and go down. And that's one of the reasons that people discuss the bridges. But we're going to look at the numbers here. So of the five bridges, the Verrazano Narrows, Pulaski, Queensboro, Willis Avenue, and Madison Avenue. Those last two bridges, the ones that go in and into and out of the Bronx, Willis Avenue and Madison Avenue, you can see from a numbers perspective, those are not really that distinctive in terms of elevation gain or grade. Those are very small numbers. However, they are noticeable, as I said, from a visual point of view, and they are definitely felt, right? Part of that is because of where they come in the race, and that is late in the race. Another significant climb for New York City Marathon, and this one is, I think, is almost never mentioned, maybe only by me, and that's it. But this climb is in Brooklyn, specifically when you make the turn onto Lafayette Avenue, and it starts at mile 8 and it goes through mile 8.5. This is a 53-foot climb and a 2% grade. So it's, you know, 53 feet is nothing particularly huge, but a 2% grade is definitely something felt. And this is very early on, and there's really no visual. It's almost imperceptible. Because you are really just making a turn and your surroundings are not indicating anything in the way that the bridges are, right? This last climb is the Fifth Avenue climb, and this is right before you make the turn into Central Park. So when you exit the Bronx, You basically get onto Fifth Avenue and you just take that straight until you get to the Engineers Gate Central Park entrance. And you will hear this climb discussed quite frequently. The reason for that primarily is because of where it is placed in the race. So here's the numbers. You gain 85 feet, which is not a small number. However, that is stretched over a full mile distance. And so the grade there is a 1.6% grade. That really is not a huge number, but it comes very, very late. You're starting just before mile 23, and it goes up to just before mile 24. So this is a really tricky part of the course because it is quite tiring. Everybody's feeling the fatigue by mile 23 and 24 of a marathon without question, no matter what the course is doing. So now we're going to look at the Boston Marathon in an overview. The one thing I want to point out here is I think you can see this clearly, right? There are other climbs in the Boston Marathon besides the Newton Hills. People discuss the Newton Hills. The Newton Hills have names. The Newton Hills are famous for where they come and their orientation being all stacked together. However, there are many, many times where you are climbing in the Boston Marathon. In fact, the entire course is essentially a series of up and down rolling throughout. So including, you know, there's a climb in mile one, there's a climb from mile 4 to 5, there's a climb just before mile 8, there's a climb from mile 9 up to mile 11. And again, there's climbs at the end. So it's just a series of ups and downs, but nobody really discusses that. What they discuss here is the Newton Hills. And there are four Newton Hills, and I have the names here. Washington Hill, which is the climb that goes over I-95, the highway. Then there's Braeburn Hill, John Kelly Hill, and Heartbreak Hill. And everybody, of course, has heard of Heartbreak Hill, even if they haven't run the Boston Marathon. Everybody's, you know, really familiar with that concept of Heartbreak Hill and, you know, being intimidated or certain ideas like that, right? But really, it's the combination of all four of these hills together. And here we are with the numbers. So we have a 75-foot climb, another 75-foot climb, a 63-foot climb, and a 95-foot climb. Now, as you can see from these numbers and the numbers we saw just this two slides before for New York City Marathon, these numbers are pretty in keeping with the other race, and the grades are really, you know, also pretty similar. However, the difference here is these hills are all very close together, and again, that's what makes it so complicated. And also the fact that it comes late in the race. But if you were to say be running, you know, if you were just running a marathon and you had a climb of 95 feet, most of the time we wouldn't think too much about it, right? Or you had a climb of 75 feet and you're out on your easy run, you know, you wouldn't necessarily go, oh my gosh, this is so hard. This is, you know, impossible to do. But it's the factors, the combination of factors that add up together, stacking, that make these things complicated. So now I'm going to rank the climbs so we can do a really one-to-one comparison. The number one climb for Boston is the Heartbreak Hill climb. I don't think anybody's surprised by that. 95 feet in a 4% grade. So it is a pretty sharp grade, right? 4%. This Braeburn Hill is a 4.1% grade. So it's even steeper than Heartbreak, but it doesn't climb as high. It's 75 feet. The highway overpass I-95 climb is a 2.2% grade, and that's a 75-foot climb. And then the John Kelly climb is 63 feet with a 2% grade. So, you know, again, on its face, nothing too scary or, you know, intimidating. Now, we look at New York City Marathon. And again, this is one of those climbs that nobody really talks about. However, the largest climb in New York City Marathon is the Verrazano Bridge, and that occurs in the very first mile. When you leave Staten Island, you cross the Verrazano to go to Brooklyn, and this is a 164-foot climb. That's a pretty big number, right? 164 feet, and the grade there is a 4.4%. Nothing to sneeze at here. However, the difference is you are starting the race. You are literally 5 and 10 minutes into the race when you are attacking this. And so it is magically fine. It is magically okay. And nobody talks about this because of where it is. So placement is very important and distinctive when you are looking at the numbers and the grades for a climb. The second largest climb is the Queens Bridge, and that is 125 feet. So climb-wise, number-wise, that is a pretty big number, right? However, again, this is one of those long graduals. This is stretched out over a mile, and it's a 2.4%. It's nothing small, and it's nothing easy, but it is, it could be worse, I guess is what I'm trying to say. Then we have this Fifth Avenue climb. And again, as I mentioned before, this is one that really trips people up all the time. But look at the numbers here. 85 feet. It's on the smaller side of things, right? And a 1.6% grade. So I live on the New York City Marathon course. I live on the Upper East Side. I walk out my door and I start running. I am running on the New York City Marathon course. I have run this Fifth Avenue climb in both directions multiple times, almost every week. If I choose to do it, I could do it every day. And as I'm saying, this climb on its own, in the absence of 22 other miles ahead of it, is not anything to be intimidated by or to really kick your butt. But because of all of the preceding things, it has a tendency to do that. Then here as number four, again, this climb that really nobody talks about at all and is never mentioned ever, 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 is this climb up Lafayette at mile 8, which is this 2% grade. So numbers-wise, there's pretty good similarities between these in terms of grades, in terms of pure elevation gain. Where do these climbs come? So this is very important, as I mentioned. That is Boston. All of those climbs stacked together, all starting past mile 16, from mile 16 to 21. And again, that's one of the reasons that this is a complicated race, is because of that stacking and these compounding factors. So New York City, by contrast, you have these four climbs. These are the four largest climbs of the entire course. However, they are divided by multiple miles between them, right? And so you get a chance to kind of recover, although, you're not necessarily recovering really well when you're like at mile 20 or 21 and et cetera, right? Because you have all of that prior mileage on your legs. But again, these climbs are spread out. So it's not the pound, 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 pound of the Boston Marathon. As I mentioned, I have run both of these multiple times, and I live in New York, so I run that course regularly, just in my, everyday training life. And I can promise you both of these courses are quite complicated. Part of mastering that is understanding the differences and the nuances between these climbs and how you want to approach them. So instead of just looking at the numbers and going, oh, well, 95 is less than 125, so that must make it easier. Not necessarily, right? Not necessarily. Placement is important. Grade is important. What has preceded is important, right? And if you were just looking at the numbers and you go, oh my God, the Verrazano Bridge, that must be the hardest thing of the entire race. It's not, I promise. It's just, again, because of where these things happen. So I also decided to, I just pulled the numbers for Harlem Hill. If you live in New York, or if you've run any of the regular Central Park halves, Fred LeBeau, for instance, or the women's shape half, something like that, then you've run up Harlem Hill. And so this is another thing that comes up often. So I just said, hey, why don't I just throw this in? So I captured some before and after the actual hill part. So this climb begins at 0.02 on my map and my elevation chart. And I've circled that right there. And that starts at 29 feet. The crest of the hill is 108 feet high. And that is at 0.4 on my little captured zoomed in hill. That total distance then is 0.38. And the total climb is 79 feet. That grade then is 4% grade. A lot of times people want to know what this compares to Heartbreak Hill. And really, it is the same grade as Heartbreak Hill. However, it is different in two major ways. One is that it does not climb as much. Heartbreak climbs 95 feet. This climbs 79 feet. Heartbreak is also longer. Heartbreak is 0.45 and this is 0.38. So the hill that of Newton that matches Harlem Hill most closely is actually the second Newton Hill, and that is when you make the right-hand turn by the firehouse. That is the hill that is most closely matched in terms of specific numbers. Hills in all of their different types are good for training, especially, well, they're good for training for anything, period, because they help you build form and strength, and you need that even on a flat race. But particularly if you have any hilly race coming up, you definitely want to know what types of hills. You definitely want to practice on all kinds of different hills and different kinds of terrain to make sure that you can conquer it and be successful on race day. That is all I have to say. If you want to, you know, if you have questions or things you want to ask me, please do leave them in the comments in the chat below. I do read them and I do respond. and if you see me on Patriots Day weekend, I will be there in just a week from now for my 7th Boston in a row. If you see me, please do say hi. And as I mentioned, I live in New York, so I'm here all the time. If you happen to be in New York, do say hi on that occasion too. All right, that's it. Thanks, guys.